This episode was brought to you by Squarespace. If I looked down at an ant by my foot, an eagle would be able to see it in the same resolution from the top of a first-story building, and if I took off my glasses, I would see just about the same as a rat. Those are pretty cool facts about animal vision, but how would you go about testing how clearly an animal sees in the first place? There are three ways you could estimate an animal's visual acuity, or in technical terms, how sharp or clearly an animal can see the world around them. The first would be to simply look at the number of photoreceptors in the retina. This can give you an idea of the maximum resolution available, although in most cases you will find that actual visual acuity is less than predicted. And there are many reasons for this. Several of those relate to the post-processing that happens after the retina has detected the light and before it is consciously perceived by the brain. One example of this is spatial summation, whereby signals from individual photoreceptors converge or bundle together into a single ganglia, meaning that multiple photoreceptors ending up sending a single signal through the optic nerve. For instance, our fovea may have a 1-to-1 ratio of photoreceptors to ganglia entering the optic nerve, whereas the macula may have a 7-to-1 ratio, and the peripheral retina a 35-to-1 ratio, leading to dramatically different resolutions across our field of view. The second would be to look at the optic qualities of the eyeball. Eyes are subject to refraction, diffraction, and aberration, which affect how light is bent and focused in the back of the eye. And eyes aren't always shaped perfectly for perfect focus. In fact, in my video about cephalopod vision, I actually explain how a squid's eye defocuses and bends light on purpose to detect colour. Our own eye shape is not perfect either, and it's the reason why some people are able to achieve a higher than 20/20 vision after LASIK surgery, because their cornea is reshaped to focus light even better than it would have done so naturally. Now, whilst the previous options give you the maximum possible visual resolution an animal could have, they don't really inform us about how they actually see, and the best way to find that out would be to use an actual eye test, and there are several ways of doing this. In humans, we just use a traditional Snellen eyechart, the Landolt test, or the illiterate test, and the way they work is very simple. You stand at a set distance and try to identify the different symbols, and the point at which you can no longer identify them marks the limit of your visual acuity. However, animals aren't very cooperative when it comes to calling out letters, so in order to test their eyesight, we need to be a little bit more imaginative. For animals such as rats and mice, it is possible to set up elaborate behavioural experiments by taking advantage of the fact that we can train them to learn things in exchange for rewards. And in this case, we want to teach them to choose black and white gratings over a plain grey display to find out how fine the gratings need to be before they can no longer tell them apart. And some researchers actually taught the rodents to do just that by making them swim in a special tank up to a choice line, where they then had to swim towards the black and white grating, as beneath it was a hidden underwater platform that would provide them with a reward. By using this setup, scientists were able to discern that rats have a visual acuity of about one cycle per degree. To give an idea, 20/20 vision is around 30 cycles per degree, and one cycle per degree is about as well as I can see without my glasses on. All this being said, as you may imagine, there are plenty of sighted creatures out there that won't pander to a scientist's every whim, and fortunately there are also other ways to measure acuity. One method that is frequently used takes advantage of what is known as the optokinetic response. The eyes of many animals naturally track moving objects from side to side, following a horizontal saccadic motion, or horizontal nystagmus, or the optokinetic response. Therefore, by placing the same gratings moving across a display or on rotating devices, it is possible to monitor whether an animal is tracking the gratings' movement or not. If they are, it means they are capable of seeing the individual lines, and if they don't, they probably can't. So there you go, I hope this gave you some clear insight into seeing clearly. I'd also really like to thank our sponsor for today's episode, which is squarespace.com. If you're seeking to make the next move in your career, you probably want a website. And as you may know, I'm planning to transition into science communication full-time after completing my PhD. So I'm currently building my own professional website for my next move on squarespace.com using their beautiful and easy-to-use templates, which is allowing me to showcase the type of work I do to those who may want to hire me. So if you want a website as snazzy and as simple as mine, head on over to squarespace.com/drawcuriosity and use the code DC to get 10% off at checkout. And if you enjoyed today's video and you want to find out more, check out links in the description, because there's plenty of cool researchers and some very, very kind researchers who let me use their footage to illustrate some of the points in this video. And as always, thank you so much for watching me, and I'll see you in the next one.